डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब आंबेडकर ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी।
नमस्कार फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर किशन जोशी फ्रॉम डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब आंबेडकर ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग पॉइंट, अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक, वन ऑफ माई फेवरेट टॉपिक्स, आई कैन से दैट। सो द टाइटल ऑफ द टॉपिक इज डेफिनेशन एंड नेचर ऑफ ग्रामर। The outline for the presentation is like this. We start with introduction, major categories of linguistic theory, grammar, nature and definition, prescriptive and descriptive grammar, grammar, the study of form versus the study of meaning, questions for further discussions for our better understanding, references for you to study more about these points. So let's start with the first point. So the moment we listen to the word grammar, it always gives us goosebumps like experience. So what it is a very basic question. It always gives a kind of a fear the moment we think of the term grammar. But it is not so. When we try to understand the term grammar, we need to understand the basics of the term grammar. The grammar is a separate, not a separate, but an internal point to discuss of a particular language that we are studying and everything. So it is a set of conventions of rules that governs language. So what is grammar? In a simple form, we can define grammar, we can talk about grammar as a convention rules that governs a particular language. So that's a basic understanding about the term grammar. Grammar rules make us understand the language in a better form. It is always important to know the structure of particular language that we are going to learn, we are going to be in, and grammar is something that always gives you that edge to understand that particular language. But according to the linguist, reality is grammar is something that is within us. Grammar is something that is within that particular language that we have acquired. Grammar is something that is not to be learnt separately. It is part of particular language. That is what linguistics theory says, and linguists even think about the same thing. According to them, we know what it is. We know the grammar itself. We don't have to be so much impatient about learning grammar. We study grammar throughout our experience of learning language and all the four skills when we through that particular process of learning. It is our learning of grammar itself. Let's start with the listening, speaking, reading and writing, all the four LSRW skills or the four hierarchical steps that we follow is an experience, does give us an experience of learning grammar. So the moment if I listen to someone, if I can understand that listening that I am getting as part of input, I know grammar. If I can respond to that, if I can give reply to that, I know grammar. If I can read something, if I understand, I know grammar. And the final process, if I can write in a response, I know grammar. So at every point, you need to know that you know grammar. And that's what linguist says. We study grammar throughout all the processes of a learning experience, learning language experience, acquiring experience of language. And grammar is a tool to harness any language. So if I want to learn any language, the basic thing that I need to understand is the grammar of that particular language. And then I'll be able to harness that language. I'll be able to control that language. So, according to linguistic theories, there are some major categories in grammar. So, any language can be divided into three different major categories. So, the first one will be grammar, phonetics, lexicons. Now, when I say grammar, it comprises morphology and syntax. And as our unit, our presentation is on grammar, we'll be more focusing on grammar, wherein phonology and syntax as both the different interdisciplinary topics, they are the subtopics of grammar. Phonetics will know what it is briefly, and lexicons, we will have a definition, a brief talk about even lexicon as a term. So, let us start with the first, that is morphology as part of grammar. According to other definitions and everything, morphology is a study that deals with the forms and structure of words. Now, when I say morphology, it is the science of language itself. It's a part of grammar that deals with forms and structure of words. Morphology is a study that studies how words are created, how forms are created, and the minimum structure, minimum unit of meaning is called, the minimum unit of morphology is morpheme. For example, if I say dis, D-I-S, is a unit that individually does not make any sense unless it is connected with a word. For example, miss. If I say dismiss, sorry, as part of morphology, the minimum unit is morpheme. That is what it call, that is what it is known as, the minimum unit of a particular, sorry, let us start talking about the term morphology. Morphology is a study that deals with the forms and structure of words. Morphology, once again, is a subpart of grammar which deals with forms and structure of words, how words come into existence. New words can be framed, new words can be made in that way. And there are certain prefixes and suffixes that are studied as part of morphology. And when it comes to syntax, it is nothing but these are the arrangements of phrases and sentences, which we also call syntax. Syntax is once again a part of grammar. Syntax study is once again a part of grammar study. The another term that we have discussed in the previous slide, phonology, phonetics. When I say phonetics or phonology, on the other hand, deals with the sound system of language. So, phonetics or phonology is about the sound study of a particular language. We study sound of particular language as part of this part of linguistics. Linguistics a branch of a language, and the last branch of linguistics is lexicon, that provides information about the individual items of the vocabulary. A range of vocabulary is what we call, even lexicon is once again a kind of a synonym for vocabulary. So, it includes words, idioms, and many other things. And one of the examples that I would like to share with you is, kick the bucket is an idiom that is very famous kind of an idiom that means die, to die. To kick the bucket means to die. Grammar, nature and definition. It has been discussed by the grammarians, by the linguist people, to know grammar in a better form, that teaching that English grammar must be taught explicitly. English grammar is absolute and fixed, and it is inherently difficult and confusing. As I said, it has been discussed among grammarians and linguists. These are the notions that we have inherited from our previous grammarians, our past grammarians, our past linguists. They have been thinking of these kind of things. These are the ideas that they have passed on to us, and we still believe in these all things. But the reality is something different. The reality is that grammar is just a skeleton of any language. A language is a living entity or creature. If I say this, it has been established, not in a literal form, but it is a living, it is considered to be the living entity, living creature, because it comes into existence, it is born. Language has a birth. Language is born, it grows, it travels, it changes, and at the end it dies too. So it has been researched that certain words have changed their meaning over a period of time. Certain words have even extinct. They are no more in use. They do not exist nowadays. If they do, the meaning has already changed, undergone a huge change. And that's what I mean to say. It dies, it changes. Language is never static. Language is ever changing creature, we can say that. And as a result, grammar also changes, because the language and grammar, they are inseparable. We cannot separate these both things. So that's why I would like to say that grammar also changes as the language change. The way language changes according to the time and place, grammar of that particular language also changes, that we have already discussed. Language changes as per the society and time. Is something, is a statement kind of a thing that we have already, I shared with you that thing, that grammar changes as per the society and time. The kind of English that we speak here, we do not find that kind, the same kind of an English spoken somewhere, some other place. The kind of English we are speaking in 21st century was not the same in 1950s. So over a period of time, in different places, the way language is used as a tool of communication changes. And it is evident that the language that does not have native community to speak dies soon. It's a very genuine kind of a fact that language lives because of human beings. It's a very genuine kind of a statement, not to be challenged, and a result is Latin and Sanskrit, both are traditional and classical languages, but as the speakers of both these languages are not in that number, the whole community, we don't have the whole community and everything to speak both the languages, they are dying slowly and gradually. They are at the edge of extinction. They are going to extinct soon. So it's a very thought provoking kind of a situation. We must think over these kind of things. And English, at the other end, is global language. It is spoken everywhere in the world, almost everywhere in the world. It is given extreme importance by every community in the world. And that is the reason that it has traveled across the world. It is spoken differently by the people of every community. And the reason that we can get the result that we have is the grammar of particular English language has also changed the way people use the language, English language. The grammar has also had a kind of a switch, had also kind of a change within it, within that particular form. And it is now depending on the speaking community. English speaking scenario in India is different from any other country in the world. Within India, we had number of states speaking English in a different way. The South Indian person will be speaking English in a different form. A Gujarati speaking will be in a different form. Maybe both the languages can be called standard to some extent, unless it is both the kind of speakers of South India and Gujarat, both are standard as long as they are intelligible. So intelligibility can be called one of the criterion to call a language standard. So once again, the question is, which language is called standard and which one not, is a separate kind of a study once again. But in simple terms, we can say that as long as we are intelligible to people whom we are communicating with, we speak standard English. The moment we are not intelligible, we are speaking something wrong. Okay, so that's the point we need to understand. So let's talk about the definition of grammar. The language definition of grammar is descriptive, whereas the grammarian's definition of grammar is prescriptive. Now, here the two terms are very important. The first one is descriptive, the another one is prescriptive. A prescriptive grammar is a set of rules about language based on how people think language should be used. So the definition by linguists is very obvious here, can be understood, that prescriptive grammar is based on set of rules that how language should be used for the people who would like to learn that language, people who would like to adopt that language as a tool of communication. In prescriptive language, prescriptive grammar, sorry, there is right and wrong language. If I don't follow the rules, I'm wrong. If I do follow the rules, I'm right. It can be compared with a descriptive grammar, which is a set of rules based on how language is actually used. There are no prescribed rules given to the speaker. It is how we used, how it is actually used. It is not how it should be used. So there is a kind of a difference in both the expressions, how it should be used and how it is actually used. Both are different scenes altogether. So let's talk about prescriptive grammar, a very famous kind of a term in terms of discussing what grammar is. A prescriptive grammar is an account of language that sets out rules for the speakers that how it should be used and for what should not be used. So it gives you an explanation of both the sides, how not, how it should be, how it shouldn't be. Both the states are there that we need to think while talking about discussing prescriptive grammar. It talks about rules of both the scenarios, both the states. It is based on norms delivered from particular model of language, particular model of grammar. It is nothing but they are the norms which are delivered to us, to the speakers. They are taught directly to us that what we must follow, what we must not follow. So these both are the things that we need to keep in mind when we are talking about prescriptive grammar. It is a set of rules and examples dealing with syntax and word structure of a language, which is usually used as an aid to the learning of that particular language. If I want to learn a particular language, I need to know some of the established rules of that particular language. If I do not know, it is very difficult for me. It will be very difficult for me to understand that particular language. That is what prescriptive grammar is defined as. Prescriptive grammar is a grammar that is taught in schools, somewhere in colleges even, which are discussed in newspapers, magazine, columns on language, magazines and columns and language which are very easily available in libraries, online, everywhere. They are discussed on a basis of prescriptive grammar, and on various social media as well. Now, when I say descriptive grammar, it is not prescriptive. Obvious definition will be this, but what it is? In contrast to prescriptive grammar, descriptive grammar describes how adult native speakers actually use a language. Descriptive grammar talks about the authentic use of language. What it doesn't talk about what we should, what must to be followed. It talks about what we need to follow, what we ought to follow. So that's what they define descriptive grammar as. Further, we can say that descriptive grammar does not say this is right, this is wrong. It doesn't talk about this point. Rather, it's an account of language that seeks to describe how it should be objectively. It doesn't give you rules before you start learning language. Rules are part of language. You learn the language, you know the rules. You learn the language, you will come to know that whether I should speak in this way or the other. Even if you speak in another form, it would be, if it is accepted by the society, it will be the part of your own language base, language data. By understanding the pattern of English, we can help others in learning the language learning process. So, there are two different terms always that dominates the language learning reign all the time: learning and acquiring. So the moment I move to learning grammar, rules and everything, I am focusing on prescriptive grammars. If I know language particularly, and if I don't know rules of that particular language separately, though I am acceptable, though I am intelligible for the people, I am correct. So that's what descriptive grammar talks about. It talks about language rules and everything in a hidden form. They are covertly explained, overtly they are not explained. They are accurately, systematically and comprehensively. They are explained in a way that we acquire language. We don't learn language in a way. We don't have to make extra efforts to know first rules and then we move to language. We apply those rules on language, and in that process, we don't have to be in that process. That's what descriptive grammar talks about. So when I say grammar, the study of form versus study of meaning. So grammar is always based on study of forms and meaning. So when I say study of forms, prescriptive grammar, study of meaning, descriptive grammar. So what it is? So grammar, we need to talk about this point as well. So traditional grammarians tend to see the straight relation between the form and meaning. So we cannot separate both the things. We cannot separate forms from meaning or meaning from forms. They both are very much interconnected, and that is what they used to think. It was very clearly explained by them, traditional grammarians, that they are very much in relation with each other. Form and meaning I'm talking about. The study of grammatical forms will deal with the grammatical categories such as past tense, interrogative clauses, passive voice, and so on. These are the things that we have been taught at our school levels. We have been learning even. We have been teaching even. So that is what traditional grammarians think. Whereas the study of grammatical meaning will be concerned with the meaning associated with these categories. So the moment if I say passivization, we need not, according to grammatical meaning, if I am studying meaning, I don't have to look into the rules that first I need to select subject, then verb, then object, then certain chemical processes I need to make, I need to undertake, I need to make some of the changes within those verbs and everything. Then I need to interchange. These are the steps that we follow as part of converting active to passive or vice versa kind of a thing. We do in class. We teach students as well. That's not the point we are going to discuss. But still, for an example, if I take passivization as an example, I would say that where shall I go for passive voice? If I want to report something where I am not involved directly, I need to be objective. I don't have to be subjective. I need not to get involved in that particular situation, action. I will always be passive in my expressions. I'll be reporting things. I'm not directly involved. And that's where grammatical meaning comes into existence. I just need to teach my students saying that if you are in this particular zone, use this kind of language. That's it. I need not to explain them, teaching them first what is passivization and how you need to construct or subject, verb, object, the hierarchy that you need to maintain and everything. I'm not going to teach that particular thing. Traditional grammar describes past tense simply as a form of the verb which expresses the meaning past time. So that's an example that I would like to share with you. Concluding the point, we can say that grammar is something that is very much internal part of language, any language, we can say that. Grammar, rules and everything that we are learning, we have been learning as part of our throughout education process, experience, journey, we can say that, are now changing. The nature of grammar is changing as the language itself is changing. Now we don't learn English as a foreign language. We learn English as a second language. As the status of English has changed, we need to even change the way we learn the language. As now you are clear with both the types of, famous types of grammar categories, prescriptive and descriptive, And ultimately, we need to decide what kind of languages we need to learn. Whether we are comfortable at prescriptive way of learning grammar, whether we are comfortable at descriptive way of learning grammar, or what is more convenient for me to be in that particular zone, that we need to decide by our own. So there are certain points that I would like to think over, ponder over. Discuss the term grammar. That's a very basic question that you need to think about. Discuss with your friends, peers. What do you understand by the term prescriptive grammar? What do you understand by the term descriptive grammar? What are the three major parts of language, or linguistics as an umbrella term, we can say that. The followings are the references that you can look into for your further understanding, better understanding of this particular point. Thank you for now. Swadhyayah Paramam Tapah.